the world says, the world body ego pretend mind says, hey, I got a great deal for you. I'll pay you to have smallpox. I'll pay you to have smallpox. And we say, really? You're gonna pay us? Wow, that's so amazing. The Holy Spirit says, I'll pay you to not have smallpox. This is an example. I'll pay you to not have smallpox. The ego says, I'll pay you to suffer. The pretend mind, I'll pay you to suffer. And the Holy Spirit says, I'll pay you to not suffer. I will pay you to not suffer. So this is the difference between the ego and the Holy Spirit. The ego has given us all these deals because it's paying us. It's, I'll pay you. Of course, then it brings in the goddess who's the blackmailer. And she blackmails and, you know, tries to say, I'll give you a free ride, don't worry. And then she blackmails other people and then she puts them in touch with one another and says, okay, blackmail them, you got the leverage, and then they keep paying for your free ride because they're being blackmailed like that. Subtly blackmailed. Subtle blackmail is the business of this world. But the real business is excuse. The bodies in this world are nothing but an excuse that spirit is using to blame futility, its own futility of trying to change God. Blames the futility on bodies and the world. Just an excuse. Bodies are simply an excuse. And the ego, the spirit saying, it's not fair that I can't change God. It's not fair that it's futile. I should be able to do anything. I should be able to change God. So the spirit refuses to say that it's futile. Spirit says, I don't want to disappoint God. God gave me this mission to change God, and I don't want to say that it's futile, so I'll make these excuses and say, well, God, it's because of the bodies in this world that they're the futility and their problems they're having. I need their help, but they're, I gotta help evolve them so they can finally help me complete this mission. I'm on to change you. and Spirit says that God will get mad with me if I don't change God. And this is an absurdity. When God extends itself, it doesn't extend itself in such a way that the extension can come back and change God. Okay, it's God does not give such power, authority, or possibility at all. Because God gives itself away entirely to the extensions. It's just the way that creation is, its spirit cannot change God. So bodies are an excuse. That's all they are. They're not what we are at all. They're just an excuse we're using. Again, bodies are just an excuse that spirit is using to blame bodies instead of spirit. The blame is on spirit for trying to change God. That's the dynamic. So spirit has to repent. In other words, give up that attempt to change God. But instead of doing that, spirit says, no. God said I had to do this. But the problem is, it's bodies that are letting me down. It's the world that's letting me down. It's this world. It's this bodies. That's where the problem is. So, of course, spirit can engineer an asteroid strike on this world and say, look at the devastation. I was almost there, God, and bodies were almost ready to help me, but oh my gosh, look what happened. Terrible accident. Don't know how that could possibly have happened. What a bit of bad luck. Rub of the green. Oh, I missed that putt, but the green was bumpy there. You saw that? Oh boy, nothing I could do about that. It's just a rub of the green. This is spirit. This is what spirit's saying to itself, trying to convince itself it can change reality. So this world and bodies are just a great excuse. Spirit has fashioned what it thinks to be a great excuse, but it's no excuse at all. What purpose does it serve except a delay so spirit can keep pretending this whole charade that God gave it this mission to change God, to change reality? So happy, well, new year, and new year. It's not going to be a happy year for most in the world, for sure. It may be a happy year for those who have an ascension attitude of ascension, and we can get that. We have 5 months to put the polish on it, and we can do that. Absolutely, we can do that. Just have to keep recognizing. Yesterday, I recognized the whole world's just an excuse. Body's just an excuse. None of these bodies are what we are at all. They're just an excuse we're making. So every single body you see, that's spirit making an excuse. That's all that it is. And that opened the door to saying, oh my gosh, I don't even have to see bodies. Why would I hold spirit to an excuse where the excuse isn't needed? Because spirit is perfect standing in reality. That doesn't mean to make excuses. All it needs to do is give up this notion, attempt to change reality. That's all. So why should we hold spirit to these silly excuses that it's making? We don't have to see bodies at all. We don't even have to see this world at all, actually. This is very true. It's simply an excuse. And you just, if your spirit will say, I don't need an excuse. I've admitted to God, this is what I tried to do, God. God knows. I don't have to admit it. God already knows. But it helps me to say, hey, you know, let me come clean here and let's repent. So I don't have to keep making these stupid excuses with the bodies. How ridiculous is the notion that spirit is a body? We're going to have a big laugh about that. That is so ludicrous. So none of these bodies are what we are at all. It has nothing to do with what we are. And what the world does is say, is this a better excuse? Or is that a better excuse looking at bodies? We're just saying, what kind of excuse do you have? What kind of excuse are you using? Maybe I can hook up with you and we'll make a better excuse together. Yeah. So the flood of ascensional insights and attitudes is continuing here. So ... new year. I said whatever I have starting the new year, that's how the new year is going to be. And in general for the world, I'm saying, well, a pretty astonishing situation happened yesterday. It's not good news for the world at all, because I had my vehicle cleaned out and everything. I said, okay, let's see what goes in my vehicle next. What does God put in my vehicle? Well, I got this emergency call. I said, oh my gosh. He says, we got this massive amount of heavy stone tiles that is extra, and you got to get it out of here. So I ended up having a ton of heavy, super heavy, black, slate black, dark black tile. Some of it's white. Most of it, a lot of it is black. And the white actually broke. The piece of white broke. Interesting. My vehicle. Wow. It just came out of the blue. I mean, just like totally bizarre situation. And I said, uh-oh. Very heavy rock. My vehicle's full of extremely heavy rock. And the stuff you can see is black, like an asteroid, like a meteor. The meteor has this very, you know, the albedo is very low. It's so dark it hardly reflects any light at all. This stuff's the same color as an asteroid. And super heavy, super, super heavy. I mean, very, very heavy situations coming. Now, that's not one I wanted in my vehicle, I'll tell you that. That's the last thing I would want. But I said, my vehicle handled it just fine. And I said, well, okay, that's just the Holy Spirit showing this is what's coming. But I'm not panicked at all. I just nonchalant, okay, that's fine, I can deal with this. Ascension attitudes. We have the tools for ascension. Again, let me state this. This is an example. The ego says, what a deal I have for you. I'm going to, not only am I going to give you smallpox, I'm going to pay you to have smallpox. I'm going to pay you to have AIDS. I'm going to pay you to this. I'm going to pay with that. I'm going to pay you to perish. Oh, wow, we think. That's really amazing. Go to deal, ego. The Holy Spirit says, I'm going to pay you to not suffer, to not perish, to not have smallpox. I'll pay you to not have this world. I'll pay you to not have an excuse. Either way, we get paid. So, choose. It's just a choice. It's just a choice. Yeah, very interesting. I was at a market, and it was very busy, all these different lines. And I said, which cashier should I go to? I'm looking at all these cashiers, like, not that one. And there's one right in front of me, is this young woman. And I said, well, she looks maybe this one is better than the others. It seemed like there's consciousness is out of whack. This one said, I don't know, we'll see. Looks like better. So went through the checkout process, and she was actually very good, very conscious. I said, wow, that's impressive. Then at the end, I all day I've been thinking, Happy New Year. Why say Happy New Year? Everybody says, Happy New Year, Happy New Year, Happy New Year. Why don't we say, like, have a non-dual New Year, have an awesome New Year, something different. So in my mind, I said, I'm going to say, have a great New Year to her. Because it's very, very somewhat aware person and conversing, you know. Most people, they don't say anything to me. But she's able to converse and go with the flow and everything. It was all okay. And so just before I said, have a great New Year, she turned to me and said, have a great New Year. And I said, that's exactly what I was going to say. So I said, well, hey, maybe there's some aware people in the world. There are. But bodies are just excuses. So maybe the spirit of this spirit was saying, I don't really want to use this body as an excuse. And it shows up. It shows up in the body. It shows up somehow. Interesting. No makeup, no adornment, just sort of a natural base, because I'm not making excuses. I feel I don't want to really make excuses. I don't want to use the body to make an excuse. There's that sort of a basic feeling like that. I'm not going to use the body as an excuse. Maybe it's faint there, but it's enough to notice there's a difference. There's some ascensional attitude there. A little ascensional attitude goes a long way. Because basically, it's just a choice between the Holy Spirit and the ego. The Holy Spirit's going to pay us to be safe. The ego's going to pay us to be endangered. That's it. See, we're nailing it down now. Now, I'm taking it easy today, and I'm taping during the day. It's too cold at night. It's so chilly here. And even today, it is very chilly. I said, maybe I should just take it easy and see if can I play golf? No, it's too cold. It's too chilly. It's really, I think today's the last of the really chilly days here, but it is. It's hard to feel your hands. It gets into your bones. So I haven't, didn't tape yesterday, but there's an even better reason than that. And that is, I use the day into intensely clean everything out, get rid of all this extra stuff. It's just unbelievable amount of work, and I'm exhausted. But did it. Succeeded at it. This happened because I had a terrible dream. Fourth dream in the last week of a recluse spider. This terrible spider in the dream was orange this time, and it's just like, it was in the room. I said, what do I do with it? Oh my gosh. Finally, I figured out what to do with it. But then I woke up, I was just shocked. I was so shocked by this dream. It galvanized me into cleaning the room, cleaning the house, cleaning this, because I realized it had something to do with the dirtiness and the congestion of the room. And so we got all the trash out, all the stuff out. It's all, just did a tremendous job. I just go, like I was on a cord of caffeine or something, but I wasn't. It was just the shock of that spider dream. And so everything, the outside is clean, the inside is clean. It's a fabulous start to the new year. I am absolutely on fire and primed and got it done because of all the flexibility and workouts I've been doing. I was in good enough shape to make this big push. So this is very critical to hear. At some point, we need to make a big push. Yesterday, it was the day for me. I said, it's now or never, do or die. So at some point, we're going to hit this do or die threshold. And maybe we get a spider dream that will scare the heck out of us. And we'll realize, wow, I got to go for it. And we need to be in good shape all the way around. So physically, I had to be in good enough shape to do that. But my back started spasming up on me. I was toast at the end of the day. But the jam on the toast was that I had set a goal 4 months ago for January 1st. I wanted to be a certain weight. I wanted to be that weight on January 1st. It's very important. Well, several days ago, I was almost 5 pounds away from myself. Uh-oh, my goal is in jeopardy. Well, got on the scale this morning. I hit my goal exactly to the tenth of a pound. Absolutely on the dot. January 1st is quite extraordinary. I just like, wow. Yeah, I didn't eat much yesterday, that's to say. I had nothing. I didn't eat anything till midnight. And then once it's midnight, and then I actually weighed myself just before midnight, and I hit the goal exactly then, and then I hit it again this morning, even after eating a big meal at midnight, after midnight. So these are like very good signs showing goals can be reached. Goals can be reached if there's a real determination to do so. So hit the ground running in 2016, and we have to hit the ground running. At some point, there's a do or die situation here where we have to make a push. So, but today I feel tired and my body sore. I mean, I was a wreck. That was enough. But good to go now. Good to go. So hopefully all this information is resonating, that there's a push is necessary. And of course, wake up in the morning and people are trying to induce me into bad habits. They haven't changed at all. Same old, new year, same habits. Guess what? Habits carry over into the new year. People make resolutions, well, I'm going to, you know, try to do this and this, this, and this. Well, you need to resolve before the new year. You need to be aware before the new year, what's your resolve? What's 2016 going to be about? So the Holy Spirit gave me a heads up 4 months ahead of time saying you have to give 4 months push to be ready for this 2016. And that's, so I said, okay, I'll commit to that. Committed to it. So commitments is important. Here's a great analogy. I had to go through all my golf stuff and realize it's time to, I got to do something about this. And had all these golf balls, all these different brands of golf balls I've used throughout the years. And I realized, I said, it's time to commit to just one golf ball. So I said, I decided the Pro V1X, it behaves all around. It's going to give me a better all around golfing experience and result. It will. I know that is true. I've tried so many different golf balls, and I find golf balls on the course. I use those. But I said, look, stop looking for, you know, something special. Go with what's proven and tested, and you know, the pros. This is what the pros use. This overall, it may not fly the farthest, may not do this, but overall, it and it's true. So I said, let me commit to that. I got to commit to one golf ball this year. I said, oh, but it's expensive. I said, well, I've got, how many do I have of them? I have a bunch of used ones. I have a plenty. I said, look, that's going to last a long time. It'll last 5 months. It's only a 5 month commitment. So I ended up giving away hundreds of golf balls, new ones, so many. I kept, but I didn't, you know, go completely crazy. I kept one box of new ones in case I play this course that you lose, it guaranteed to lose about 10 golf balls on. Maybe I just won't play that course though. I'm thinking that too. So I may get rid of those also. But there's a huge purge. And let me tell you, that was painful, painful, painful. I said, this is just killing me. I went back on all these golf balls throughout the years, going back 10, 15 years. I still had all these, you know, I just said, wow, I'm giving away all these new golf balls. Oh my gosh. It's horribly difficult. But I did it. I did it. Some golf balls I just bought a little while ago. Oh, I got to give away these brand new golf balls I just bought. Why don't I use them on the course? I said, no, 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 no. That's what got me in trouble. Yeah, just a minute, please. There's another extremely bad habit. Wow, I'm surrounded by bad habits. Always, but the ego's paying me to be induced into bad habits, right? The ego said, well, I'm paying you to have smallpox, so what are you complaining about? Well, I'm complaining because the Holy Spirit will pay me to not have it, and that's a much better deal. So you offer me a terrible deal. The ego thinks it's offering a deal in a vacuum, like there's no competition. I said, no, there's competition, the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's going to pay me to not have smallpox.
Good grief. Yes.
Wow. Terrible. Even I said, don't interrupt, I'm busy, busy, busy. Still interrupting. That is just awful. Incredible lack of awareness. Over trivial sweets, you know, just bad habits. I got to keep my bad habit going. You're not helping me keep my bad habit going. I'm paying you to keep my bad habits going. The ego, you know, this is just, it's awful, this world. Truly, it's an atrocity, you know, this excuse we've made. So the ego thinks there's no competition. It's paying us to die, paying us to suffer. The Holy Spirit will pay us to not die, to not suffer. So the ego doesn't like competition because it'll show what a terrible, terrible offer it has for us. Ridiculous. So I drop hints. I want to take it easy. I want to know. You see, those who are not aware of the Holy Spirit think the ego has the only offer in town. So they're just trying to maximize that offer, get the most out of the ego's offer. The ego's paying us to have smallpox. What a deal. Right out of bed, boom, inducement to bad habits, inducement to bad habits, inducement to bad habits. Here, I said, no, 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 no. I was in the store, and someone came around with chocolates, this lady with long blonde hair, beautiful, glamorous lady. She goes, can I interest you in having a chocolate? Can I interest you in having a chocolate? Interesting. And I said, sorry, I can't break my resolve. You know, I got a resolve for New Year's, and I can't break that resolve because, of course, I had to hit this weight. And she goes, oh, okay, I understand. But I was tempted. She tried to induce me into bad habits. Chocolate's a big no-no. And here's this glamorous blonde-haired lady, the goddess, trying to induce me into bad habits. That's all that the goddess does, is induce us into bad habits, but it's by saying, can I interest you in a bad habit? Can I interest you in a bad habit? Just think of it that way, all these glamorous goddess figures. Can I interest you in a bad habit? No? Well, how about, can I interest you in this bad habit? And they'll, you know, glamorize themselves more. Can I... this is true. This is a truism. This is not, I'm just not making this up. I'm laughing about it. But this is the world. The world's an excuse that Spirit has made. Spirit made the world. Spirit made bodies as an excuse. So I've explained why. So can I interest you? No, I cannot. You cannot interest me. Well, now I have this resolve. I'm you know, you got to understand. So there has to be some way to say no. And later on, she's still going around the store looking. She saw me, and she goes, oh, okay, he already said no. I don't want to push things right now. But the timing was very, very clever on her part, right before New Year's like that. Just at a time when my weakness, I was very tired, my weakness would hit me. And, all afflictions in this world, the ego is offering us. Say, can I pay you to be traumatized? I'll pay you to be traumatized. I'll pay you to be a victim status. I'll pay you this. Well, what kind of payment? Well, the ego will say, don't worry, I'll leverage it all. I'll make people feel guilty about this and to make them, you know, serve you out of guilt and all these things. It's the leverage of guilt. But nothing can happen to us if we don't first decide that's what we've decided to have happen to us. Because the ego is actually just a fake mind, pretend mind. It's spirit that's just actually making an excuse, but pretending that this pretend mind is the one that is involved with this. The pretend mind is no mind at all. So we have this scenario now where the Holy Spirit is... There's such a constellation of plausible inference has taken place that I have to at least go with it as a plausible, as a strong plausible inference that something is coming. Reason isn't saying yes or no. This isn't based on just reason is open and shut. I mean, it's this is plausible inference. Because to say for sure something was coming would be somewhat overly stressful, I think. So to leave it, the door open to the most plausible inference, then at least that's enough motivation to work on ascension attitudes. Many of us are working on ascension, this ascension attitude, the attitude of ascension. Many of us are working on the attitude of ascension in various ways. So our the one that counteracts the ego goddess complex is the Holy Spirit. Primarily the Holy Spirit. It's not a body here. That doesn't work well. Especially using a female body of a genuine guru, because the overwhelming tendency is the ego is to use the goddess complex as, can I interest you in a bad habit? Can I interest you in a bad habit? Can I interest you in a sickness? Can I interest? So if we use a female figure for ascension attitude, this strengthens overall the idea of accepting an offer from a female goddess figure. And the problem with that is the overwhelming tendency is for us to accept bad habits from the goddess figure. This is what I've experienced. This is what I've experienced. So it's a very... not a good thing to use a female figure to interest us in ascension attitudes. This is what I have discovered through brutal, brutal suffering, actually. What happened was an Anandamaya female figure interested me in ascension, very much so. But along with that, then I also became vulnerable to all these glamorous goddess figures interesting me in bad habits. I came along with it. So I became vulnerable with that. Because I said, well, this reminds me of Anandamaya Ma, so I'll say yes. You know, I felt this kind of thing, because she's a similar traits, attitudes of a female figure. Became vulnerable to that. So I said, wow. Let's put that down as a lesson learned. Way better to have male figures, in my opinion. Plain, simple, non-glamorous, to just talk with reason, appeal to our reason, appeal to reason. The appeal here is to reason. And this is what the Holy Spirit's appeal is to us, is reason. The Holy Spirit doesn't have a form. There's nothing to glamorize there, nothing to adorn. But the Holy Spirit has an entire realm for us. Can I interest you? I'll pay you to not have this world, to have a better world. I'll pay you to not suffer. I'll pay you to not die. I'll pay you to be truly happy. I'll pay you to be blissful. The ego says, I'll pay you to be miserable. And we think, well, thank you. I was going to be miserable anyway, but you're going to pay me? Holy cow. What a deal. But the Holy Spirit says, look, I'll pay you to be blissful, to abide in bliss. I'll pay you to abide in bliss. chilly. I'll pay you to not be chilly. So the Holy Spirit has an entire realm, death-free realm. And maybe more. This is maybe just the tip of the iceberg, but I've seen the death-free realm. I'll pay you to come here. I'll pay you to come to the and stay in the death realm. The ego says, I'll pay you to come into this world and stay in this world. I'll make it worth your while. The Holy Spirit says, I'll pay you to abide, to go to the death-free realm and abide in the death-free realm. I'll make it worth your while. So the competition in this world is between the ego and the Holy Spirit. And the funny thing about this world is most of us here completely ignore this fact. And say it's just the ego, that's it. Of course, the ego has to claim it has no competition. That's the only way it can stay in business. If we became aware that the Holy Spirit, that the ego has, the Holy Spirit is competition, then the ego would soon be out of business. Which means the pretend mind would be out of business. But that doesn't mean that the true mind would be out of business. It's the idea of trying to change reality would be out of business. We'd have to let it go at some point once the continuity fears have evaporated. But the ego would be out of business. So, of course, being a shrewd, shrewd business person, the ego, or business pretense, the ego promotes this notion that there's no such thing as the Holy Spirit. It's just, you know, it's the Easter Bunny. This is just the ego trying to stay in business, that's all. But this is what's being taught in school, being taught everywhere in the world. Even in churches, there's not much emphasis on the Holy Spirit, actually, which is a shame. Rarely, going to Catholic Mass, rarely do they mention the Holy Spirit. It's in Chalcedonian Creed, is mentioned in there. But overall, the homilies, it's in there, but it's not being emphasized. It's sort of in the background. It's in the background, the Holy Spirit actually is. The emphasis is on Jesus and more on Mary, the goddess figure. Which is, can I induce you into bad habits? Even the good habits, the goddess induces us into our bad habits. Yeah. Because taken as an end in itself, that's a bad habit. Even good habits taken as an end in themselves are very bad habits. This is not to say we should cultivate bad habits, right? No. Cultivate truly good habits, which is accepting the Holy Spirit's offer. That's the end game. Accept the Holy Spirit's offer. The end game is not merely good habits. So if you get like a woman who doesn't adorn herself, who's plain, who doesn't glamorize, those are very good habits. The goddess like Virgin Mary can aspire towards that. But the problem comes up when that's taken an end in itself. This is a big, big problem. Because ultimately, that's still the ego. It's still the ego. Because they're not really recognizing the Holy Spirit. They're recognizing the Virgin Mary, but not the Holy Spirit. This is the problem. It's the Holy Spirit that's the true liberator. So, very, very interesting byplay here we're having in the background. Speaking of Mary, yeah. But this is true. They say, what I've said is absolutely true. That good habits in themselves, if they're not coming from the Holy Spirit, are coming from the ego. And they're superficial and misleading. Superficial and misleading. So you had a Mary Magdalene who truly repented, at least if the Gospels are to be believed in that way. And Jesus said, this one has done very, very good because she was super, super glamorous, very bad habit person, but she decided to listen to the Holy Spirit. And he said, that is what is good. That is what is truly good. Truly what I'm asking you to do, not just to be a nice woman, a good woman, I'm a pious woman and stuff. That those are still bad habits if they're not coming from the Holy Spirit and integrated into an overall paying attention to the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit has an offer for us. Holy Spirit is in competition with the ego in terms of business offering us. What, see, this is what we have to become aware of. So if we're just saying, "Well, I'm a good woman, I'm a good person, I'm modest," but we use that as an excuse to not listen to the Holy Spirit. Say, "Well, I'm good enough. This is good enough." Then that's a very bad habit, actually. So Jesus was pointing out, the Gospels point out, if I don't know if it's a story, a parable, if it was the very brilliant spiritual people who wrote the story, but if we take it as real, then Jesus is pointing this out, that this is, not that he wants women to be prostitutes, not at all. Okay, but the more important issue is he wants us to truly repent and don't rely on just the good habits. He castigated the Pharisees, the Sadducees and the Pharisees for this attitude of self-righteousness, how they were good and holy people. He said, "I tell you, I came for sinners, not for the righteous." Okay, this is interesting because the righteous say, "Well, we already have good habits, Jesus. We don't need the Holy Spirit." But Jesus is saying, no. You need the Holy Spirit because you're still agreeing to the ego's offer. I'll pay you to die. And the ego says, "Don't worry, as long as you have good habits, maybe that's your payment." So we're selling ourselves short that way. So Jesus brought a new gospel. Instead of just good habits, he did not say cultivate bad habits. He said cultivate really good habits. Not just behavioral habits. Those are fine. But you have to go beyond that, which is dedication to paying attention to the Holy Spirit, dedication to the voice of reason within. Look within the mind, recognize what's going on, and accept the Holy Spirit's offer. So his point was a notorious prostitute, which is what Mary Magdalene was. She was notorious. Who has repented is vastly better, incomparably better than a righteous woman that has not repented. This is what his message to women was. Okay, this is what his message, because women have a tendency to play the role of, "Well, I have these good habits, and what more do you want?" Or they play the role of the notorious prostitute, inducing everyone into bad habits. Mary Magdalene will induce so many into very bad habits. She is very notorious. But you couldn't induce Jesus into bad habits. And that was what she was looking for. She says, "Wow, that's it. I'm through with this. It's not what I really want. Because it's just a game that Spirit's playing, an excuse. I'm inducing people into excuses." She says, that obviously doesn't work. Jesus has shown me that's not the way. And apparently, in the Gospels, she truly repented. But then they try to make it seem like, well, she did induce Jesus into marriage and having children and all that. That's nonsense. Okay, that's absolute nonsense. That's the ego trying to put a spin to save its hide, to save its business. The ego will say anything to save its business. Because that would not be repentance. It would just, really, the whole thing about Mary Magdalene and the ego's way of looking at it is to say that the whole Jesus thing was just nonsense, just much ado about nothing. It's the ego, just ego trying to stay in business is all that it is. But if you look at it the right way, then it's a powerful, powerful message to the women of the world. See, Jesus favored Mary Magdalene over his own mother, over Mary, by a long shot. His mother may have been a very pious Jew, I'm sure she was. Very chaste, very modest, a model of female decorum and morality, yes. But that's not what Jesus came to call us to. It came to call us to beyond that, which is good spiritual habits of paying attention to the Holy Spirit. So it was Mary Magdalene's the one who apparently repented and truly paid attention to the Holy Spirit. So Jesus said, this is a better example than my own mother. So interesting, huh? Why we worship Mary and don't pay attention to the Mary Magdalene in terms of this lesson that real repentance is what's required, not just good habits. And that the good woman can trip up people worse than the notorious prostitute by having them think, oh, this is good enough. This is good enough. It's not good enough. Pretty awesome stuff here, huh? The ego says this is all boring. Of course it's going to say this is boring. This has got to stay in business. I mean, if we pay attention to this, the ego's out of business. So of course it has to say that I'm terrible, I'm a horrible person, I'm boring, I'm this and this. I got a comment like that just castigating me for just being like the worst person in the world. That ego has to say that. I took that as a great compliment because that means that I'm really hitting home. It's the opposite of boring. It's fabulous. It's amazing. It's awesome. It's exciting. It's like, wow, we're getting this ascension attitude that we need. So we might say, I can't leave all these good women behind. These good. Oh, yes, we can. Oh, yes, we can. Well, if we do that, we'll just have to take up with notorious prostitutes. Oh, no, we don't. Oh, no, we don't. We take up with repentance. We take up with the Holy Spirit. I guarantee you that someone who's truly repented, they're not going to go back to their old ways. Mary Magdalene says, I'm through with that. That's it, once and for all. I have repented. And there will be no more of that. And I will dedicate all my attention to the Holy Spirit now. And push through with that. Come what may, push through with it. So those who have repented are very, very serious. People don't like hanging out with me, say, you're too serious. Well, you're darn right I'm serious. Who is it that ensnares from the male standpoint, but this is just spiritual, really, everything's spiritual politics. It's the good women that ensnare. And so then what we do is say, oh my gosh, who will free me from these good women? And then the notorious women come and say, I'll free you, don't worry. And we think, oh good, this will get, but then the notorious women induce you into terrible habits. And then you think, I'm lost, there's just no way out. But then repentance comes, the Holy Spirit comes into your life. And then you realize, wow, it's neither the good women nor the bad women that are the answer. Both of those are the ego. It's the Holy Spirit and its offer. It'll pay us to not be a body. It'll pay us to be blissful. It'll pay us to be free. It'll pay us to be eternal. It'll pay us, it'll pay us to go to the death-free realm. Hey, I like that business that it's in. I like the business model of the Holy Spirit. It's interesting that the notorious women, they know they're looking for the men who have gotten sick and tired of the good women, realizing that's not it. And then they swoop in on you. And you're easy prey. They're like a bird of prey, like a hawk up there in the sky, looking to see, okay. And then they see the prey swoop down, wham, hit it just like that. This is blatant. When you become aware of this dynamic, then it becomes more and more obvious what's going on here. And they say, hey, let me interest you in bad habits. The good habits don't work, but hey, the bad habits, they're really fun. Let me interest you in bad habits. How many men have fallen prey to that and hit on that? Oh, the number is legion. So, is you looking for a Mary Magdalene? No. Look, we look for our own repentance And if someone else has repented, fantastic, that's great. But our business is our own repentance. And the good habits is our spiritual practice, our own spiritual practice. It does not require special relationship, special partnership, anything like that. You can treat anybody and everybody as practice. Every situation's practice. Everyone is practice. This is how I look at it. There's no special practice. There's no special practice partner or anything like that. Everything is practice. Whatever situation you're in, whatever arises, this is practice. This is a call to repentance. This is a call to say no to bad habits, including the good bad habits. The bad habit of goodness. Jesus, again, railed against goodness. They called him good. He says, don't dare call me good. Don't you dare call me good. That's exactly what I came here to expose, is the falsity of egoic goodness, as well as the falsity of egoic badness. Both. It's the same. Serves the same business model. The ego serves the same purpose. Excuse making. The ego, spirit wants an excuse. Spirit wants an excuse. Bodies in this world are an excuse, so it wants to keep the excuse going. It wants good excuses for futility. Its own futility. Bodies are nothing. They're just neutral projections of spirit. They just provide, spirit is providing itself with an excuse. Look at this excuse. Look at the needs of the body. Body doesn't have any needs. It's all projected upon the body. The whole body is just nothing but a projection of spirit. So this is a great New Year's Day gift to see. I had never seen this before until just now, just when I'm speaking it. The good woman, bad woman dynamic, holy cow. That's all the ego. It's both of that's the whole dynamic's the ego. And the church is idolizing Virgin Mary, whereas Jesus put Mary Magdalene ahead of her. By far, because she's the one that who got it, and Mary did not get it. Still thinking about goodness, being good. I'm a good woman. So the church is promoting goodness, not repentance, and not ascension, not salvation, not repentance, and not the Holy Spirit. It's de-emphasizing all that. It is more and more and more emphasizing Mary. This is a fact. I've got the front row seat to all this, so nobody can pull my chain on this. I've made it my business to be aware of this. And of course they think they're being righteous. This is they're teaching the path of righteousness. Jesus said, I'm not teaching the path of righteousness so much. I'm condemning the righteous and their attitudes, thinking that's good enough. I'm going to bring you the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. I'm leaving, and in my place, I am giving you the teacher. Your teacher is now the Holy Spirit. It's not me, it's the Holy Spirit. The Comforter will stay with you all your days and clarify everything that needs to be clarified for you. I don't know how much more obvious Jesus could be. And we still don't get it, because we're still caught up with the Mary, Good Mother falsity here. So neither the good mother habits nor the bad prostitute habits do we want to cultivate here. We want to cultivate the habit of right spiritual effort here, which is listening to the Holy Spirit, paying attention to the plausible inferences that it gives us. I've never had the Holy Spirit say anything to me in words that I can ever recall. It's always been plausible inference, which is a gentle, very gentle, loving, compassionate way, right? Because it leaves plausible other interpretations. If I say, well, the most plausible interpretation is this, and then it gives another situation, which reinforces, then another situation reinforces. So it gently reinforces truth to us. It doesn't just blast it at us saying, my child, you know, like someone channeling Mary or something, my child, you know, this is, Jesus is very angry at you. God is extremely angry at you and going to smite the world if you don't repent and don't have better habits. And we're going, God is going to be so angry, he's going to destroy you, the wickedness and blah, blah. That's not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gently reinforces plausible inference. It doesn't deny that the ego is using this world as an excuse and could very well smash civilization to smithereens. It has done so in the past, has a habit of doing that, actually. You see, you got to understand, we have to understand the ego has a habit of destroying civilization. Do you think, do we really think the ego has changed? No. The more we get hoodwinked by the good mother syndrome, the more blinded we are to what the ego's really up to. It's a very, very, very strong signal. We think, oh, all is well with the world. The good mother will see us through. No. The ego smashes civilization to smithereens over and over and over again. Great excuse for spirit, right? Ego is just the excuse making of spirit. Spirit making an excuse for its own futility of not being able to change reality. Because it thinks that God gave it all power, it should have the power to change reality. Well, that's like saying that you're given all power and you have the power to destroy your own power. That's not all power then. God, whatever God creates is eternal. So God does not create the ability to destroy its eternal nature. There's no such capability or power at all. That doesn't mean we're not all powerful. We are. We're all powerful in that we have the right to express our power and freedom. But we don't. We can never lose the power of freedom. We can never take it away from ourselves. So we're engaged in futility, and we're refusing to accept this because of continuity fear. We think like, oh, we got to keep doing it. So we keep making excuses. Oh, it's the body. We need the body. We need civilization to come. You need to hear this over and over and over, that this earth is needed for the universe to be complete. Humanity has to reach a certain threshold in order for this plan to be complete. You hear this over and over, channeling from ascended masters, various space entities, on and on and on. This is all the ego. And what happens? Civilization is smashed into smithereens. And then they say, oh my gosh, we almost made it, but humanity failed us. Spirit's saying, oh my gosh, just almost got it, but some terrible something, I don't know, we don't understand, it slipped out of our grasp, and we failed. This is excuse making. Of course Spirit's going to make very clever excuses. There's absolutely nothing that needs to happen with this world, our humanity, our bodies, or anything at all for truth to be true, for oneness to be one, for the light to be 100% pure. Nothing whatsoever. There's no attainment that Spirit needs at all. There's no plan that Spirit has to have to work out to succeed at what it's trying to do. It's all an excuse. So over and over and over again, we get tricked, the same dark odd trick, and we're being tricked again. I mean, you read all of this channeling, most of it, not all of it is bad, but most of it, ascended master, descended this, we're getting, this overall theme is the same thing. And also, they always say, oops, something happened. We thought we had it all figured out, but something we did, inexplicably, we overlooked something and caused it, our plan to fail. And we realize we have to make better preparations next time. Well, so they'll say, well, this time it failed, but that was because God is very mysterious. They always claim that God is inscrutable and mysterious and can always throw something, a curveball at us that we didn't expect. They say, well, we had it, our computers had it totally figured out, but God did something to ruin it all. So next time we'll factor that into the computers too, and it'll work again. Next time it'll work. No, the curveball came from us, from the very one who's claiming to have it all figured out, intentionally wrecking civilization to use an excuse, say, oh, that's why we failed, that's why the futility is there, we almost got rid of futility, but civilization got, just human civilization, this world got destroyed, that's why we failed. That's where the futility is coming from. This is a complete displacement for our spirit. So it doesn't repent. repents means that, hey, God, I feel futile and failing because I'm trying to do the impossible. I'm trying to change what change reality. So I want to give that up. So I want to accept the Holy Spirit's offer. The Holy Spirit's going to pay me to dwell in the death-free realm, you know. I think I'll take that offer. Thank you very much, God. That's repentance, not blaming, not excuse-making. There's no excuse for failure. We're failing because it's impossible. This is what Spirit refuses to acknowledge. We're failing because we're trying to do what's impossible. And Spirit says, nothing is impossible. You hear this over and over and over again in the world, through advertising, whatever it is. Nothing's impossible. You can dream it, you can do it. There's no such thing, nothing's impossible. Well, yes, there is. We can't change reality. We can't disempower ourselves. That's impossible. But Spirit keeps saying nothing's impossible. So futility, it can't be futile. Therefore, there must be a way. And so it's making these excuses. It says, I have a plan. This is going to work out. There's all this cosmic plan to work out. Oh, God ruined it somehow. I don't know why. It is 100% an excuse. We don't need to keep engaging in excuses. This is ascension attitude. Now, by pointing all this out, I am not saying you should go to extremes. Like, for instance, like women should not walk around in sackcloth, shaved heads in sackcloth, because that's putting on the good woman shtick. You know, like, look at what a good woman I am. I have good habits, which is, as we know, that's the more insidious trap of them all. So just, Buddha said, the middle path. There's a good advice, middle path. So just be yourself, be low-key, be humble, be low-key, unpretentious. When in Rome, do as Rome is due to a certain extent, but just keep focusing on the Holy Spirit. Don't have to shave your head, go around in burlap, and say, look at me, look how I've gotten away from bad habits and stuff. No. Don't make a spectacle of your good habits. Pay attention to the Holy Spirit. Nobody even knows I'm paying attention to the Holy Spirit other than making these videos. But as far as socializing, no, I don't. I don't know what people think of me. I just not much of anything. I just seem kind of non-existent. That's my legacy. I was never here. That's the legacy I want to leave. Is that I have no legacy. I was never here. That's the best legacy of all. Best legacy of all to leave. Right? The Ramana Maharshi, I didn't do anything. I was never here. Never here, never did anything. Great legacy. Wow, it's chilly. We are not used to this. This has been an extended period of time. It's like we're all hovering in our huts, you know, heated huts here. Just like, I'm not going outside. It's the kind of wet chilling that you feel on your legs, your feet. My feet are cold, my cold legs, everything's cold. I should wear, I don't have any boots anymore, you know, because it's been warm for 4 years. We had no reason to wear warm weather clothes for the last 4 years at all. So I don't have those heavy boots anymore. I got rid of all my shoes. I got rid of so many clothes and shoes and all this stuff, just out with it. Still have more to do, for sure, but I got to take a break today because I'm worn out. Hit it hard enough, let's put it that way. Hit it real hard. And this is showing up in the video here. I've been able to hit this very clear clarification, which Jesus came to make, and very few have been able to make it since. We struggle with this because the good woman syndrome tricks us. We certainly don't want to fall prey to the bad woman either. And I'm using this in spiritual talk. It applies to everybody, actually. Because, of course, the inducement to bad habits comes generally from the goddess, the woman. And the men are the enablers of this. They're the enablers. So we're all involved in this excuse in terms of this dream figures that we're identifying with. But this information that Jesus brought is very, very important. And to be able to express this clearly today, January 1st, 2016, this is a very big step forward. And you have times in the world where the good women realize it's not working so well, and they flip over and become the bad woman. Women absolutely are flexible this way, because it's just all pretense. The whole male-female thing is mental pretense. These are just, this is all pretending. So you can see, like, a society, a good woman society, will flip over into a bad woman society. Absolutely, it can happen, and then it can flip back. All spinning our wheels, getting absolutely nowhere. So the attention in the world should not be on women at all. It should be on the Holy Spirit. But because women are the great inducers into the ego's excuse-making, the bad habits just lead to believing in the ego is the only business in town. It's very important not to put attention on them. Absolutely. Very, very important. It is something the ego just absolutely won't accept. It's furious about it. The attention of the world now is on women to an unbelievable extent, to the worst notorious extent in history right now. That just shows you how bad the times are. There should not be any attention on women. A truly spiritual woman doesn't want attention on herself. No, 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 no. And you can see there are some around. There's some Catholic women that are good. There's a great, you know, Christian women, but women from all religions and even atheistic, whatever. Humanist, there's some who say, I don't want any attention on me in any way. I don't need, I'm paying attention to the Holy Spirit. That's where my attention is on. And so don't pay attention. They don't want, that's fine, that's great. So, but the ego wants all eyes on the women, all eyes on the women right now. And it brings up all these victimization stories to try and get attention on them. Oh, we got to do something about this. But it's all designed to get the attention on women, because the ego wants, again, to use them, this pretense, to make us believe the ego has a great deal for us. Paying us to have smallpox. Wow. What a generous benefactor the ego is. Paying us to have cholera, typhoid fever, and cancer. The ego say, I'll pay to have cancer. I'll even give you health insurance to have cancer. I'll even give you a hospital to have cancer. I'll give you a surgeon to have cancer. Wow, the ego is awesome, isn't it? This great healthcare system we have. The ego's paying us to. We say, wait a minute, I'm paying a lot of money in that. Yeah, the ego says, but everybody else is too. And this enables me to pay you to have cancer. And people are saying, well, that's a pretty good deal. Literally. I'm not just, this is just not metaphor. This is literally what's happening. This is literally how it goes here. We disguise this severely. The Holy Spirit will pay us to not be sick, to not be tired. It pays us for better and better and better and better and better experiencing. It pays us to that. Pays us to go to the death-free realm. How about that? So this video is great. I'm enjoying this. This is like the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Always give thanks to the Holy Spirit. And don't struggle with the information. Don't try to go back, you know, what did he say? What? No, just thank you. Just say, thank you, Holy Spirit. Wow, let me just get used to this. Let me just get used to this. Holy Spirit says, I'll pay you to get used to this. So, you know, how is the Holy Spirit going to pay us right now? This, I'm looking forward to it. Now, I was going to play golf today again. Holy Spirit said, no, And then I recognize it's too darn cold. It's not smart. Probably pull a muscle. I'll get too fatigued. This is not good. So the Holy Spirit said, I'll pay you to tape. So, and the payment is, right now, is this realization of a good woman, bad woman. It's the same thing. It's the same, it's both the ego. It's both the ego. Wow. And good habits, the right, the Pharisees, good habits are also bad habits if they're not in the context of paying attention to the Holy Spirit. If they are in the context, then that's fine, because they can be helpful, right? We don't want to be all sick, miserable, even though we can do it then. All the attention I've paid on the Holy Spirit has been when I've been extremely sick and miserable my whole life. So I said, I got to do it. So that can be a benefit. Actually, that can be a benefit if you're miserable. This is what I found. Just like that spider dream, I said, hold on, I got to get this done. So, you know, be careful of just contentment and good habits and contentment and the world brings here, because we tend not to feel the intensity of pressure. Whereas if we feel like, wow, I'm really suffering, I'm not happy, this is miserable, what can I do? And then pray to the Holy Spirit, then you start getting clarification. But so many in this right, we live in a self-righteous world, very much so. They're going after contentment. But there's nothing wrong with beautiful surroundings if you use that to augment the Holy Spirit, if it's in the context of the Holy Spirit. That's all important. Anything that's in the context of the Holy Spirit is beneficial, even suffering it, and even living a life of ease or beauty. If it's in the context of motivating you to pay attention to the Holy Spirit and its true teachings, and allowing yourself to accept its offer, and recognizing this is all, the world and bodies are just an excuse that spirit is hallucinating, really, to project its own futility upon this hallucination and blame the hallucination for its failure. That's all that's happening. So if it helps you get ready for the Holy Spirit's offer, then that's beneficial. But if it's merely to provide indolence, then it's not necessarily beneficial, right? If you go to a very peaceful place and you feel the peace, you say, oh, this reminds me of something that I feel is familiarizing me with something better, then that's Holy Spirit, can be Holy Spirit content, context, as long as it's wide enough. We keep widening it to realize this can be an entire realm, not necessarily this world at all. Not necessarily this world at all. The idea we got to make this world a better place, that's the ego. That's the ego. I have to say this, even though I know there's some very, very, very good people, spiritual people who say this, and have even been involved with Course in Miracles, Jesus, etc. They say, we need to make this world a better world. That is not true. That is not true. We don't need to do anything about this world, actually. Holy Spirit has an entire realm for us. That's why Jesus left the world. He said, I'm going to my Father's kingdom, my Father's house. That's my dwelling place. Very clear about that. He didn't say, no, I got to stay here. He could have stayed here in immortal body. He could have stayed here. He could have still been here working to make this world a better place. Let me build better roads and better bridges. And you know, what do we make the world a better place? Better road. Keep in mind, we have to upkeep all this stuff. It's a world of impermanence here. We have to upkeep the roads, upkeep the bridges, upkeep the infrastructure constantly. Men are very aware of this because they do most of it. The hard labor, good grief. Yeah, I used to patch roads. I know what it's about. That's no fun. And repaving, servicing, tear off the asphalt, resurface the roads. This is their work crews constantly repaving, surfacing roads everywhere. Doesn't just happen by magic. So there's all this brutal slave labor in this world to make a so-called a nicer place, so that these nice people with good habits can drive on nice roads and go to nice homes. Well, there's all the plumbing and all the electricity and all the foundation work and all the roof work and all everything that goes into building a home and then maintaining it and remodeling and redoing it and all the roads to get there, all the water, I mean, the massive effort for infrastructure. These are people who, blue-collar workers, who have to go out and work every single day, very hard, tough, difficult labor and dangerous labor. So that the wealthy people, the nice, good-habit people, can have a life of ease here. So, of course, they don't want these people to know about the Holy Spirit and its offer, because the blue-collar people might say, hey, wait a minute, I think I like this offer better than the ego's offer. So there's a tendency to make religions, the aristocracy tends to make religions, which keep the blue-collar, slave-labor people ignorant of the Holy Spirit. And it seems as though, to me, Catholicism and Christianity in general is another example of this, that they twisted it, they distorted it, the aristocracy. What I have seen studying history, I'm very good at that. Plausible inference is that the brand of Christianity we have now actually came from the aristocracy of the Roman Greco-Egyptian Empire that said, this is the way we want it. This will serve us our purpose as well. Work hard, have good habits, be righteous, you die, you go to heaven. Perfect blue-collar, aristocratic, like psychotic and aristocratic, combination of those terms, aristocratic trip, right? To fashion a religion that tells the blue-collar workers, look, just be governable, okay? Be easily governable, meaning have good habits, have good work habits, so you get up every morning and do your slave labor, and be very governable, and when if you do that, you get to go to heaven. And here's our promise of it. You just go to this church and get a wafer, and that will make sure that you go to heaven. Perfect religion for the aristocracy, isn't it? Keep them in ignorance of the Holy Spirit. And if anybody comes up preaching among the blue-collar people, like, hey, the kingdom of heaven is now. Now is the kingdom of heaven. The Holy Spirit is the liberator. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Off with their heads. Off with their heads. It's been the history, hasn't it? It's been the history of this world, hasn't it? Absolutely it has. Not just Christianity. I mean, this is basic egoic. Egoic control 1, 2, 3. I've had a blue-collar life. Blue-collar life. I also spent a lot of time on the aristocracy in previous lives. Was actually part of the aristocracy. Then spent time with the highest aristocracy last lifetime as an artist. And then this lifetime, I've been blue-collar. So I wanted to look at the situation from the standpoint of blue-collarness. You know, like, hey, what's really going on here? So this is why people kind of can't figure me out. I look aristocratic, I act, but everything else is blue collar. I got no position. I'm just a slave, just a drone slave here. Spent my whole life just cleaning up garbage, blue collar. But I wanted to see what's really taking place. What's the whole trick here? The ego is tricking us. How is spirit tricking itself? Now I know, so I don't have to stay blue-collar, and not have to be aristocratic either. And we have to say that the blue-collar excuse people, they don't want to know the truth, most of them, actually. No, they don't. They're kind of happy saying, wow, aristocrats symbolize truth to them, and they say, I don't want to know it. So I'm kind of happy here with my tailgating and football game and all this stuff. Really, I mean, they're pretty happy at what they're doing. Because they say, well, at least it could be worse. I could actually realize truth. Don't want that. And the delusion they have is that the aristocracy knows truth. The aristocracy doesn't know truth at all. They only know control, enslavement. So if you get the aristocrats who try to change things, the blue-collar people don't like that, actually. They don't. I'm always amazed at the gardeners that get up and they're doing the garden works. Oh yeah, I kind of enjoy this. Are you kidding me? It's horrible. Maintaining this garbage dump of a world, you enjoy it? What they really mean is, well, it could be worse. I don't have a choice. They say, well, I really don't have a choice. Meaning, I don't want to have a choice. I don't want to choose for reality because it scares me. So I'm not fooled by the aristocracy. I'm not fooled by the blue-collar slave class either. I'm not fooled by either class. Not fooled by the good woman, not fooled by the bad woman. Thanks to the Holy Spirit. Thanks to the Holy Spirit. At least it's trending in that direction. The familiarity, the trend in familiarity. It's a plausible inference to say I'm not fooled by it. Less and less and less deceived by it, thank God. But I'm not going to try and measure where I'm at. Just plausibly inferring this is how it's looking. The blue-collar class is not interested really in liberation. They're interested in acquiring the perks of the higher class, but not genuine liberation. Slaves oftentimes don't want to be liberated. That's why they're slaves. They don't want to be. So the idea of trying to bring liberation to the blue-collar didn't work. Didn't work at all. Complete failure. Bring it to the aristocracy didn't work either. Failure. But how about those who've been both aristocracy and blue collar and realize neither one of those is it? Maybe that's the new class that you know, what we call it, the middle class, but that's not really it either. Somewhat helpful, I would say. I would say the middle class, which is, I was born middle class. This middle class is more helpful. I was born middle class with upper middle class pretensions. Actually, the family dropped down from upper middle class. The ancestors were actually high class, went down into upper middle class, then dropped down. The Great Depression knocked them out of that. And then we're middle class, but still roots in the upper class. But then me, I went down to lower class to check that out. Didn't need to look at the upper class or, you know, anymore. So the middle class, you can kind of check out both the lower class and the higher class and then decide, like, hey, you know, maybe neither one of those is the answer. But it kind of leaves you feeling classless in a way, really. It really does. The middle class is sort of classless feeling, which is not necessarily very good. It doesn't feel very good, but it's not supposed to. It's not an end in itself. It's not an end in itself. It's a means to an end. The middle class is a means to an end. Middle class is getting wiped out right now. In Silicon Valley here, the people identify as middle class, and we can put in that demographic, it's been an astonishing decline. I think it's gone from 67%, what did I say in previous video, to 11% or something. And I said this would happen, is being wiped out. You're either now rich or poor. And here most people are rich. You have to be almost. We're clinging to the middle class, but we're barely surviving. Good thing we only have 5 more months left to go, basically. But, and those who are, you know, smart social scientists have been talking about this trend. This is what's happening in the world. The haves are getting way wealthier. And the middle class is being pillaged to support the poor class, all as a scheme of the upper classes, actually. The idea that there's these, you know, I'm for the middle class politicians. What a bunch of liars those politicians are. They're paid liars by the upper class aristocracy. Paid liars. And they con the middle class into thinking that they're for the middle class. No, they're for the poor slave class, to strengthen that class and to pull the entire middle class into the slave class. So you have this aristocracy and the slave class. That's it. That's what their goal is. So they've destroyed the middle class, these politicians. All the while beating their chest saying how they're for the middle class. Again, the politicians, don't forgive ourselves for falling prey to them. They're notorious liars. They're the best liars that money can buy. The aristocracy identifies who are psychopathological liars and then puts them in power as politicians. The aristocracy doesn't govern anymore in terms of overtly. It uses these so-called middle-class politicians who are nothing but spokespersons who are psychopathic liars, and puts them in charge of countries for them. They work for them. But they're able to put on a very good act of like, no, I'm a person of the people, a man of the people, woman of the people, for the middle class. They're extremely good liars. And so, you know, I mean, our spirit sees through it. For me, it took me 5 minutes. I said, I'll pay attention. The spirit said, okay, you see it? I say, yeah, I see it. That's it. Where most people still don't get it. So we can see through it if we want to. Most of us don't want to. We're too afraid to. Because then we say, oh my gosh, I got to stay in the middle class. That means I have to, it's really, I don't quite have a stable feeling, which means I've got to look for stability where? Spiritual stability, which means I need to pay attention to the Holy Spirit, which means hard work, tough work. Great work, actually. It's better to say it's great work. The great work, I have to do the great work. That's the whole purpose of being born in the middle class, do the great work. You don't have the privilege to frivolously squander your life away, and you don't have to brutally work as a blue collar, you know, brutalize your life, blood, sweat, and tears. So you're too exhausted to do anything other than just work. Neither one. So it's the opportunity to do the great work, in which I seized the opportunity and have tried to make the most of it for sure. And I don't understand why more have not. It's just been a great opportunity. Maybe some have. Some have. Out of the middle class, maybe more than I realize. It's just that it's not clear at this point just how many have done it. But here and there you see non-dual this, non-dual that. These are middle class people, most of them. So I believe that there have been more than we know take advantage of this opportunity we had, and now it's coming to an end. 5 months more, and then it's at an end, in my opinion. Which is, you know, that's the way the cookie crumbles with the ego. It has to keep making excuses. It's got no choice. That's what it is. It's the excuse maker aspect of spirit projecting the need for excuses, for futility, for failure. For failure to change reality. Oh, the excuse is civilization. I needed to raise up great civilization and sustain it. Oh, it collapsed. How terrible. That's why I failed. Spirit doesn't have to do anything to fail at what it's trying to do. It's inherent failure. It doesn't have to do anything to fail. I need to do nothing to fail. It's failure is inherent in the effort to try and change reality. So I don't need a world, I don't need bodies to fail. Absolutely do not. The idea itself has nowhere to go. So just accept the Holy Spirit's offer of a death-free realm, which resolves the continuity fear for us, and plausibly infers that reality hasn't changed at all, no matter what our efforts have been. And it's good. All's good. That's all is perfect. That's it. So, graduation time for those who have used their time wisely. Some of the aristocracy in the past supported various teachings. However, they seem to always support it in such a manner that it ultimately ends up serving their interests of keeping the working class ignorant. So they will keep being slaves, thinking that goodness is their salvation. Being easily governable is their salvation, going along. I know this is how it is. The blue collar, they know their place, they know their role. And they think, oh, I'm being a good person, I'm working hard, I'm going along, I'm building the homes, building the infrastructure, keeping everything maintained, doing all this, getting the energy thing, and so I'm going to go to heaven because I'm a good person, and I did what my superiors told me to do, which they think represents God. I remember most people used to think that aristocracy came from divinity, that the divine right of queens, kings, aristocracy, they're divine. So if they were easily governable, they thought, well, that's God's plan. God's plan for this world, you know, to be fruitful and multiply, to care for the world. No, that's the ego. The ego says we need to fashion a really good excuse. So when it fails, we have a great excuse. Hello, are we waking up? Are we waking up here? We certainly are. You know, the sun is trying to peek out among clouds, but it doesn't do any good at all. Right now, the sun is very feeble. In these days, it just doesn't have the juice. You think, ah, there's the sun. And we're so used to the sun in California bringing warmth. I just see the sun, I say, oh, you know, hey, let's go outside, it must be nice. And so when it's not, it's a shock to us, like, wow. So I've been preaching to the middle class, really to everybody, but especially the middle class. They should have ears to hear this, and not many have paid attention. Pretty surprising. And it's not because this message is off track. I don't believe it's off track at all. I believe it's right on the mark. Just like I hit my weight perfectly on the very day I needed to hit it. I have a track record of pushing through goals and meeting the goals exactly right on the day to the dot. I have a very whole life has been that way. So I don't believe this is the lack of listening comes from, oh, this is just nothing to hear here. It's that we're still tricked by the good mother, bad mother thing, the good woman, bad woman, good habits, righteousness, all this stuff. We're still have those habits of either blue collar or aristocratic habits are still percolating in the middle class, because some of the middle class, again, comes from the aristocracy of, you know, they drop out. They're not able to maintain it. Absolutely. Just like, for instance, dropping down into the poor class, if you're middle class, you're still going to have all those middle class habits and beliefs, right? But just now, you know, blue collar, poor class. Although many blue collars make up a lot of the middle class, but when I'm middle class, meaning professional class that doesn't have to use the brutal labor of their bodies to make a living, so to speak, professional class. Supervisors, they may work in blue collar jobs, but they're supervisors generally. Managers, accountant, you know, they don't actually go out there with a jackhammer. The professional class, and they're struggling to survive. They don't want to get pulled down to the lower classes, of course, but this is folly, because if they paid attention to the Holy Spirit, they would have known that the ego has this plan to wreck civilization, to make a severe excuse for spirit. And it's really, of course, spirit planning to wreck civilization to give itself an excuse. We just use the term ego as if there's some sort of mind doing this other than spirit. There isn't. The ego really doesn't even exist. It's pretend. It's all spirit that's doing this, 100%. The ego is just a label we're using for this dynamic of wrecking civilization and deceiving this self-deceptive dynamic and making excuses. The ego is the great excuse maker. This is what I've discovered, the whole path. All the ego does to me is say, hey, I got a great excuse for you. And I turn it down, the ego gets real upset and says, ah. Then it says, okay. And then it comes back later, so I got a better excuse for you. And that's all it does. It just makes excuses for failure. That's all it does. That's all that's going on here, just excuses for failure. I don't want excuses for failure. Yeah, it's cold everywhere in California. I mean, you can't. Well, the state high was like 66 yesterday. Good grief. That's ridiculous. But at least if you're like in dry desert, you don't feel it's not a chilly. Here it is. It's very chilly. That breeze. I don't want that breeze touching me. It's a chilly start and an ominous start to the new year with that being. Given a heavy load of this heavy, heavy dark stone. That I don't know how you could be more evocative than that. It's extraordinary. A set of very odd circumstances led to this situation. Someone called me up and says, hey, could you do me a favor? I really, really appreciate it if you, you know, put this in your vehicle. And I said, wow. I didn't have to, but I said, okay, Holy Spirit says do this, I'll see what it's about. And then turned into this. I said, wow, this is pretty strong. And, you know, it's not the only Holy Spirit. The various great teachers have indicated, too, there's curtains for this world. There's curtains for this. The ego plans to wreck civilization. The aristocracy, of course, already has underground dwelling places. They do. They absolutely do. This is so they know they have some inclination of what's coming. Some have been tipped off. But their plan is to go underground. So they've spent the last how many years, maybe 40 years or 50 years maybe. They've been at it for quite some time, heavily at it they have underground earth equipment that can tunnel and excavate underground and do a lot of work underground. Of course, there's a lot of open space underground, actually, way more than we realize. And what they do is they tunnel between various these spaces and they set up underground civilization, which is common in the universe, underground civilizations. Very common, because you get the heat from the core and you've developed various sophisticated electromagnetic energy sources, etc. So for them, they just go underground and wait until things calm down here, and then there's an agreement the extraterrestrials will come here and terraform the world, bioform, bring in, you know, terraforming, or they will reintroduce the new civilization here, a new civilization here. Fourth dimensional type of civilization. So the aristocracy is really not worried. I mean, they got the blue collar people to build them all the tunnels and the underground, you know, do everything to set them up nice and cozy underground civilization. That's where they will go. And they've pretty much already completed it. I mean, they know how to push work projects through. They really do. Got to hand it to them in terms of their industriousness and management like that. They get to keep the capital flowing. And they can get a whole lot done in a hurry. And I'm not trying to blow the whistle on anything. This is just what's happening here. And Luke, you know, the rest of us don't have access to those situations. But we have access to the Holy Spirit's realm. right? Or realms. I don't know what the full extent of it is, but certainly we have access to the Holy Spirit, and it's offered to us. So we're not trapped like lemmings here. Middle class, nobody's trapped like lemmings. Now the aristocracy, they don't want to go to the death-free realm because they're used to controlling slaves, and there's no enslavement there. There's nothing to control. There's no industry to exploit. I mean, you can't do anything. Everything's immaculate. You just enjoy it, and that doesn't suit their, you know, they feel that they're special and they want to, and they need to serve the ego. So it doesn't serve the ego's purposes, and the aristocracy feel that they've get their privilege because they're serving the ego's purpose. So they're not going to go to the death-free realm. Most likely they won't. The ego doesn't like it. So they're in the business of the ego. They're very good at the ego's business. And they want to continue that, thinking it's beneficial for them. But again, this is all, remember, bodies, worlds, are excuses the spirit's making. These are not real entities. None of these bodies are entities at all. None of these pretend minds are minds at all. It's fake pretense as an excuse. Spirit's just using all of this as an excuse. And there's no we that is getting used. It's just spirit is just fooling itself, trying to excuse itself from its own arrogance, from the futility of its own arrogance. Instead of admitting its arrogance and the futility of it and repenting, it tries to excuse itself from this by blaming it on human people, human bodies, human people, blaming on the aristocracy, blaming on this, blaming on this, blaming on that. No, this is just using all this as an excuse. And it didn't arise from somewhere else. It's all arising as an hallucination of spirit. Hallucinations don't leave their source. They're not external to their source. They're not external to the causation. Effects are not external to causation. They're not external. They're still in the same mind. When the mind's hallucinating, the hallucination is in the mind. It's not external to it. Perception makes it seem external. There's no externality to the mind. The mind can't send anything separate from the mind, project anything separate from the mind. It's impossible. All projection remains, the causation always remains. The mind is the one doing causing the projection. Projection never has a mind of its own. Projection never has a mind of its own. Illusions never have a mind of their own. Hallucination never has a mind of its own. Oh, I miss the nice weather, that is for sure. We all do. We're suffering through it, but I'll tell you. I think South Lake Tahoe was, last night was like, I think it was -3 degrees Fahrenheit. Wow. This gives you an indication. It's cold in the mountains right now. Fahrenheit 32 degrees is freezing. It's -3 degrees at South Lake Tahoe. I can hardly believe that, but I think Truckee was like 5 degrees Fahrenheit. South Lake Tahoe, 3 degrees minus. I don't think I want to go there. I have this idea of going to Tahoe, but that's been a long time. I don't know if I've ever been there in the winter, but I don't think so. No. That's really cold. A lot of snow. A lot of people are up skiing, that is for sure. professional classes and the aristocratic classes are all up skiing. Of course, the aristocrats are in Vail or Aspen or Jackson. I mean, some, you know, the really ritzy, expensive places, and the rest of the people are up at Tahoe and various places in the Sierra and wherever, you know, right? the place where the professional class goes. And the blue collar just hoping for playoff football so they can tailgate, you know, just a little longer. Get the Hennessy and the fried chicken and enjoy the culture. Looking back, hindsight is now shedding light on my life. Just wow. These are the mistakes, these blunders. Stumbling into this pit. Wow. And yet these are blunders that seem almost unavoidable. It's what we do with our mistakes that's important. Is we have to learn from them and clarify and then get hindsight and say, so we don't make those mistakes again. So I don't blame myself for the mistakes. Looking back, I say, wow, how could I have avoided those? It's just extraordinarily difficult. So is a life well lived to get clarification and hindsight and realize, oh, wow, that's what I did. That's the mistake. So it won't happen again. That's a life well lived. I won't be an excuse maker for spirit. I won't side with the idea of littleness. So I'll side with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has the Spirit's best intent, best, what do you call it? Interests. It has His best interests in mind. Absolutely, it does. The Holy Spirit knows the best interests of Spirit perfectly. So when we side with the Holy Spirit, we're siding with Spirit, plain and simple. We're just not siding with spiritual arrogance, which was a mistake on our part. That's all. It was just a mistake. Is this going to keep recording or not? It's trying. It's hiccuping a lot here. But it's still going. So we'll just keep on going here. The chill. Just chilling here, literally. We're just chilling here. We're starting the new year off full blast here. This has just been a full blast video for sure, as they all have been, really. But it just keeps getting more and more intense. Recognizing our mistakes. Just keep working at it. It comes into focus. Commit. I say commitment is the new resolve for 2016, commitment. I committed. I said, I'm just using one golf ball now. If I have a shot that I think I might lose my golf ball, I'll just use a Pro V1. I have some of those left over too. And I'll use a Pro V1X for the other shots. And hopefully get better. And actually, what I'd like to do is play on a golf course where I don't lose so many golf balls. That'd be nice. Or get better and smarter and don't lose them, and that way I can just play the best golf ball and not worry about it. Maybe I can use the same golf ball for four rounds. I don't even know if I'll be playing golf anymore, actually. Don't know what the situation is financially going forward. Don't know anything going forward, but I did say the Holy Spirit could give me some substantive help at this point. I've seen what I need to see with the whole blue-collar, aristocratic, upper class. You call it what called the one percenters now. You've seen the dynamic between the slave class and the one percenter class. And so I don't really need to either be either one of those or avoid either one of those, actually, at this point. I don't need to avoid the one percenters and condemn them. Or, you know, it doesn't matter anymore. So I think my investigations of the slave class is enough. Is enough. This is what I feel. I really been the lowest of the low in the slave class, and gotten the picture from the bottom up. That's been interesting, for sure. And the one percenters will spread a new religion for the slave class, that they'd like some goddess religion is what they prefer. Actually, Jesus is too close to home for them. They say, "Well, that's a little scary. Can you just give us a goddess?" Middle class are more into Jesus. The lower classes are more into Mary, more into the goddess. They just want the good mother. Good habits. She helps them remain easily governable, which they feel is pleasing to God. And of course, when they screw up, she's very forgiving, and they like that too. And so, of course, this all is much to do about nothing. If civilization is to be utterly crushed, then the future will be reconstituted at some point, for sure. But I understand how the reconstitution works, at least to some extent. The new religion, actually, maybe technocracy of the slave class. Technocracy. They love it. Robots, gadgets. Oh, my gosh. They all have smartphones now. It's funny. You see these people are like destitute, the lowest of the lower slave class, etc. But they still have their smartphone. For sure. Absolutely, they do. I don't even have a smartphone. That's how low I am. Because I have the Holy Spirit. That's the ultimate smartphone. I mean, come on, even the up 1%ers don't have that. I got the ultimate gadget. And you can have it too. It's free. It's really free. I know all the technocracy, they love this thing. It's free, it's free. When you hear free, you go to a website, free, 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 everything's free, dial free, do it free, sign up for free, 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 free. And then they always catch, oh yeah, but there's a big watermark. Oh, but you can only upload this amount per month. Oh, this is, but there's a bandwidth limitation. Oh, but there's and 100 different things that make it basically useless. And but if you want to join and be professional, then it's going to cost you an arm and a leg. But sign up for free. And they think they're fooling. Yeah, they think they're fooling people. I mean, this is hilarious. Well, I guess they are fooling people. A lot of people, very clever at it. At least they think they are. It's actually baby stuff. You know, it's just ridiculous. But the Holy Spirit really is free. In terms of your access to the Holy Spirit, nobody can stop anyone from paying attention. Their attention. Holy Spirit works through attention. It's an attention getter. It works through our attention. It is not, don't just sit there and think the Holy Spirit is going to start talking to me and tell me what's what. It works through attention. Now the Holy Spirit can work through various people here, teachers, etc. Like for this situation here, talking can explain and clarify. That's part of what it does. But you have to put your attention on this in order to do that. Maybe getting your attention on this is a very difficult thing to do, and the Holy Spirit will help you at that. But there must be a massive resistance in the world that more have not put their attention here. This is the only conclusion I can draw, and it is certainly playing out. That people's attention is severely boxed in right now. And only the Holy Spirit is capable of freeing our attention from this box. This is what I've seen. The attentional box is the worst prison there is. It's a terrible prison. And because we're not even aware of it. We think we're just living our lives, but the habits of our attention, what we're willing to pay attention to, that is the prison. That is the prison. It's an invisible prison. A prison without walls. And the Holy Spirit has worked with me for now 40 years. Almost 40 years. Let's see. If we count 1978, when it I've worked with the Holy Spirit my whole life, but when it really kicked into high gear and I really agreed to that the Holy Spirit was my teacher. 78, let's count that. 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95. 109, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It adds up. Let me see. It's hard to, because if you count this year and 78, it could be 40 years, couldn't it? Let me see how to do this. 78. 9, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 90, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 2,000, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 2010, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is the 39th, be the 39th year. Okay, 39th. 39th year. And it's always work with attention. Subtly. Like, you'll say, I'll suddenly feel like, I feel like looking over here. I just got this feeling like I want to look over here. Oh, my gosh, I saw it. I said, oh, that's important for me to see that. I said, you know what? If I hadn't felt like looking over here, putting my attention over here, I would have missed that entirely. And I was just going along like with blinders, and I just had this intuition to look over here. I don't know why I had this intuition. This is the Holy Spirit. And this has happened just thousands and thousands, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of times with me. I just feel this intuition of like, maybe I should do this, maybe I should pay attention to this, maybe. And I do it, and then boom. There's this very, very key recognition and insight, and it triggers an insight in me. I say, oh my gosh, I never would have thought about this and seen this if I hadn't have, my attention hadn't have shifted a little bit like that. So the Holy Spirit's the great attention shifter. It's the great attention shifter. Now, it can shift our attention off of this world, off of bodies, off of this world entirely, actually, ultimately. So let's shift our attention to the death-free realm. Yeah, the body isn't doing anything. The body is not an impediment, actually. Not really. It seems though it is. Christians feel the body's going to be transformed into a light body. That's possible. Not only Christians, but ascensionists. This is possible, sure. But even that, I don't know if that, how necessary that is or not. But certainly the body wouldn't have any needs. But the form could still, there still could be a basic form or something. That's possible. But again, the Holy Spirit is a great attention shifter. Without that, the ego is in charge of our attention. Which was the ego? Just the spirit making excuses for its futility and failure to change reality. So when the ego, spirit-ego dynamic is in charge of our attention, it's going to keep our attention from recognizing. It's going to keep it away from recognition. And this is a prison. This is our prison. This is our entrapment. I know that all my spiritual brothers were calling out and saying, help, 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 just a general scream for help. And I heard the call. I said, well, I got to do something. I just can't not respond to this. And coming into that, they said they were trapped. And coming into this world, I said, where's the trap? Where's the trap? Well, now I know it's attention. Our attention is the trap. Now, we can't lose our, we can't get rid of attention. There's awareness. We just have to put our awareness in the service of recognition of what's going on here, this excuse-making dream. And that will only happen with the Holy Spirit shifting our attention for us, because the Holy Spirit has our best intentions in mind always. It knows what we truly are. And so it's able to shift our attention to gradually begin to recognize more and more and more, and we get free of this terrible prison that we're in. It's a prison of attention. We are trapped in this prison without walls. So I have been able to recognize this now. Now, non-dually, you'd say, of course, no one's trapped at all. But pragmatically, you could speak of that we're trapped. You could say that. I think that's at least right now, I feel that's justified for people to scream, I'm trapped, yeah. Because it's attention. Attention. We keep our attention, the ego keeps our attention on its business and what it's offering us and how great that is, and keeps us from recognizing the Holy Spirit's offer to us, which we need to solve the continuity problem. Now, of course, non-dual theory would just say, well, everything's already perfect. I'll go, yeah, well, that's true. But we have this pragmatic problem of not recognizing this. And what can recognize that except our awareness? So if our awareness, if we refuse to recognize it in our awareness, we won't recognize it. So that is a pragmatic problem, right? I mean, it's a pragmatic issue that of entrapment. We feel entrapped, just like I feel cold. If I went in the house, I'd be warm, sure. But I'm taping here, so I'm cold. And if so, the prison has no walls to it. It's an invisible prison, but it's a prison. It is true. The prison of our attention, the prison of our attention. And I tell the Holy Spirit, I'm putting so much effort into this, and you're helping me, and yet nobody, almost no one, is watching these videos. I say, what is going on? This is bizarre. And the answer is attention. Their attention is still frozen. Frozen attention on the ego. And of course, the ego tries to blame me. He says, well, you're doing a lousy job. That's not true. It's not true. I've done a great job. It's the frozen attention of the ones who are trapped here. Even if you go out and make a spectacle, they may momentarily put their attention on you, but then the ego will divert it again. Quickly it's diverted. So we have to turn to the Holy Spirit, which is the great attention shifter, which shifts our attention only in line with our best interests, which is to set down our arrogance, is to repent, set down our arrogance, and realize we can't change reality, and realize reality then is still perfect. The Holy Spirit has that interest always perfectly in its mind. So it's always acting in our best interest. So it shifts our attention with our best interest in mind always. This is the only way to get free of this prison. Whether we state it this way or not, it's still the same. It's all about our attention, that is for sure. It's not like we can have truth without being aware of it. Truth is aware of truth. That's it. Truth is aware of truth. The now is aware of now. The kingdom of now is aware of now. So our awareness has to be there. So, I'll have to, you know, profit from all this experience of making efforts to help and not really helping here because of this attention problem. And have to listen to the Holy Spirit of what to really do about it. So far, I don't know. And this will have to be revealed as we go along, ultimately. What's the best way to really help out? Is it really to come into this world like this? I could talk like I'm blue in the face if nobody listens. How does that help, really? Although at some level they are listening. So maybe this is being very helpful. It's just not showing up right at this moment. It's registering in everyone's consciousness. And at some point they'll feel it. It's like, hey, even when our attention was completely diverted, the truth was still being expressed here. So it is possible. And they'll get this feeling later on in some other time and place, like, hey, you know what? It is possible to listen to the Holy Spirit. So maybe it'll work out that way. I don't know. I'm speculating. I hope so. I hope so. I'd hate to think that I spent my life slaving away on helping out here and it had no effect. That would be... It wouldn't be very, very, maybe Let's put a sad face on that. Sad emoticon on that. How are we doing here? Yeah, very great. Wow, looks like we're going to get a nice run here, huh? Although, I wouldn't mind if it ended somewhat sooner than that, because it's very chilly. This world's a very chilly place right now. The attention habits of the world are very nasty. Very, very nasty. And I don't know. I don't know if I can do anything about it. I've done my best. I'll keep trying. But it may be that the Holy Spirit will say something, do something, and help me out. You know, some point here, say, hey, you don't need to try to go overboard. Just, it is what it is for right now. And then I can, I don't know. But certainly, it seems as though the frozen attention of this world is just horrendous right now. Truly horrendous. I told Jesus, you could come back, Jesus, walk around, no one's going to pay attention to you. I mean, for a moment they might, but their attention habits are so terrible. They will lose attention on you, for sure. This is what my report I have given to Jesus. I said, I think the attention here is very badly frozen. Now there might be some women who say, "No, I can get the attention here. We'll walk down the street naked, you know. They say, look, everybody's paying attention to me." Yeah, but put the clothes back on, and then they stop paying attention, and they start talking about the Holy Spirit, and their attention's gone. So, that's not really any advantage at all. That's just grandstanding. So again, we have to be careful not to grandstand at this point. Got a frustration. This is what I'm seeing. Is the danger that I'm in is I might try to start grandstanding in some way to try to get unfreeze people's attention, and this will cause too much stress on me. And it may be to avoid grandstanding. Out of frustration, I may be driven to grandstanding. This is the thing I have to avoid that. I went through a phase where I was so frustrated, I tried to see how can I grandstand this so get people, unfreeze their attention, but caused me massive trouble. It didn't work. I tried, for sure I tried. I could definitely grandstand. Absolutely. But it may be uncalled for at this point. I don't see how the tension of the world can unfreeze at this point. You know, it's too caught up in lurid news stories, you know. Huge victimization, folks. Isn't this awful? Huge crimes. The perpetrator is being brought to justice. We got to pay attention to this trial, upcoming trial of this terrible perpetrator of victimization. You know, oh, everybody says, oh, I got to put my attention. Ego wants to say, I'm a good person if I pay attention to this. Yeah. Everybody's hypnotized by their attention is hypnotized. It's a hypnotized world. And so all the grandstanding in the world, that isn't going to seem to do anything at all. Again, I saw it in a dream. Jesus has come. He said, I'm back. In spirit, he's back. He says, I'm back to just relate with you as a friend. Let's just walk together as friends. That's all. Who wants to do that? Everybody was too timid. Their attention. I was the only one that I saw said, okay, I'll do it. Because their attention, their patterns of attention but I was aware that there were some who were thinking about it and wanted to, for sure. So it's not like I expect to be the only one. I believe there will be others, but who knows? I mean, the freezing of our attention here is just grotesque. Grotesque. So hopefully everyone has good resolutions. Don't watch the news. Don't follow any news story. I don't care what it is. Even if it's the impeachment of the president or something, don't follow the news story, any news story at all. Even if it's a nuclear war, don't follow the news story. Don't follow it. Even if it's some disaster, don't follow that news story. keep your attention on the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit wants it. So I guess the prayer of the 2016 says, Holy Spirit, please keep on shifting my attention in the way, in my own best interests, which is meaning the interests of Spirit as it is, not trying to change what it is, but as it is. Please keep shifting my attention as effectively as possible. And this is all I ask of you. What more can I ask? Because this will ultimately lead to us accepting the Holy Spirit's offer, paying us to not suffer. Pretty cool. Of course, in reality, there's no need for any payment or anything, but because we've instituted this payment thing of getting stuff, the Holy Spirit is pragmatic, so it'll pay us to not suffer. So I look forward to those shifts of attention, very much so. They can't come quickly enough, really. I mean, just let them come today. Let them come right now. But the Holy Spirit, ever the pragmatist, gently provides a constellation of attention shifting. Little here, little here. And that gradually kind of says, clues us in a little bit more. I did clean the windows of a vehicle. Outside, clean them all, and inside, at least the front and rear windshields. Clean them. Very, very strong cleaning job. Got the tires up, right pressure, gassed it up, ready to go. So I'm really fired up and ready to go. It's a sign, meaning the vehicle is ready. Clear vision. The glass is very clear. So, some substantive help? Absolutely, why not? There's no class that really can pull rank on another, actually. The only ones that can pull rank are those who have been paying attention to the Holy Spirit. And whatever the Holy Spirit does to help them, guide them towards accepting the Holy Spirit, paying for them to be safe, paying for them to be well, paying for them to not suffer, paying for them to be blissful. This is then what's appropriate. So appropriateness is the ultimate class in this world. Okay. Doing what's appropriate in terms of the context of the Holy Spirit, that's the highest class there is in this world. So if that means some substantive help, that's fine. There's no judgment on that at all, if that's what's effective. Or if it means living on the street, if that's supposed to be what's helpful, then fine. That's appropriate and that helps, then that's the highest class. So I'm not saying, what is and what isn't. Whatever it is that the Holy Spirit brings us to, that's what's most beneficial for us, and that's the true classiness. Be classy. Stay real classy in that way. But it's up to the Holy Spirit to define this, what is true classiness here, and how that plays out. And it's different in each one of our situations, so don't judge, don't judge others. Just do what the Holy Spirit is, how it draws your attention. Every path is custom with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is able to have custom paths for everyone, which is why religions generally fail, is they try to lump everybody into this, we must, do this, take the Eucharist, you'll be saved. The Holy Spirit is aware of everything, simultaneously, every detail, all the way, without time interfering in any way with this awareness. So it knows exactly how to help your attention as well as someone else's attention. It might be different, might be very different, because our defensiveness and our familiarity patterns are different. So it simply designs the path for us moment by moment, which is most effective for us in everyone's case. So I can't tell other people exactly what to do. Absolutely not. But I can clue everyone into these general principles. Oh, it's cold here. I'm in the shade. Of course, it's everywhere shady kind of today. I'm not of the industrious class. And someone asked me, how come you're not, you kayak and out and and scuba dive out in the cold Pacific. And I said, I'm not that hardy. No, I am not. And I realized I'm really of the philosophical class. About, you know, philosopher, philosophical class, so to speak. I'm not of the hardy class at all. I tried to be the hardy blue-collar class. Actually, the 1%ers are pretty hardy, too. Some of them are very much, some of them. They like adventure. I try that, and now I freeze. Yeah, I easily freeze, so I don't like that. I certainly have tried, but I've suffered from it. I'm philosophical. I can sit here and talk and express and clarify all day, every day. Let them try that and see how well they do at that. They will fail miserably at that. So I hardly should be looked at as some weakling, you know, inferior person or class because I'm the philosophical class. You know, I can't do the hardy stuff as well as they do because they can't touch this at all. They can't do this hardly at all. So you might say they're the ones that are failing. Really, because ultimately this is what has to be done. You're not going to just get it kayaking. Although, who knows what the Holy Spirit can show them kayaking. And then they tip over, you know, uh-oh, I'm in big trouble. And then get somehow miraculously righted. And then they say, hey, how'd that happen? So the play of attention can happen in any situation, anywhere. You know, don't put anything past the Holy Spirit. Everyone will be saved, no matter what their habits of attention are right now. The Holy Spirit is the absolute pure genius at shifting attention. And will do so for every one of us. No question about it. 100%. Guaranteed. Nothing I need to do about it to make it so. God created the Holy Spirit perfect. Perfect functionality. The Holy Spirit has already saved everyone, actually, just through its perfect functionality. So, again, you know, no matter what I do, there's no way that I can block the Holy Spirit from saving others. Nobody, no way anyone can block anyone else from truly being saved. The patterns of attention, the Holy Spirit has it all under control. All of it under effective control with our best interests. Always perfectly clear to the Holy Spirit. That doesn't mean that, you know, some will be saved, you know, right now, accept the Holy Spirit's offer right now, and others will delay because their, you know, their arrogance is still very strongly at play in terms of continuity fear is very strongly at play. It takes a while. And they may be still trying to block the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit's still there for them. Any tiny little willingness they're willing to give the Holy Spirit instantly uses it. So they'll get out of it too. Holy Spirit will lead them out of darkness for sure. We don't have to be here for that to happen either, actually. If we can help the Holy Spirit, fine. If not, fine. It knows how to use us effectively too, but ultimately, the pure play of attention can happen without some teacher saying, hey, I'm a teacher, this is what I'm teaching and stuff like that. Right in the flow of everybody's struggle. Even though they can deny religion, deny truth, deny, they can't get around the fact that their attention is still in play in all ways, and somehow it's at play. And the Holy Spirit is the master at playing with attention, truly. Is the pure genius, is perfection at playing with attention. So we can't beat that. We cannot beat it. We can deny it, we can delay it, but we can't beat it. So never can we defeat the Holy Spirit in the play of attention. It's impossible. So, you know, if you can't win, you might as well join it. You're right. Why keep fighting against it? It's a battle we can never win. God made sure of that. Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Oh my gosh, this car doesn't have a heater right now. I keep thinking I need to put a heater in, and I could do it, but I'm not that industrious. That's the only problem, but I actually could. And if it stays this cold, I just might. I don't know. But then some will say, why did you go to that expense to do that? I don't have the, but this helps me. You see, not having the money to pursue any industriousness keeps me if I'm doing that. Although I did try and suffer greatly from it. But yeah, you say, oh yeah, I could buy a heater and do this, but that might take, you know, a day of my time, and trouble and difficulties and stuff. But instead, just forget it. I don't have the money anyway, so I'll just sit here and tape. It's very beneficial to not have money in some ways. Or if you do have money, use it up in vacations in some way, or going somewhere where you're not being industrious. This is how I see it. Instead of plunging it into projects. Oh no, I'm tired of that blue collar project thing of, oh, let's do some more stonework. Let's tear this out. Oh no, been there, done that. Oh God, let's re-landscape. No. I've done that. Been there, done that, all of that. Let's take a nice vacation. Let's go golfing. Yeah, I could stand for that. Let's stay away from industriousness. Stay away from the news, stay away from industriousness. Nothing better to help one stay away from the news than golfing. Be a golfer. Because all you're thinking about is you're around. Like you get home and there's like all this lurid news on. You know, lurid news trying to get your attention. And either that or football games. And you're saying, oh my, it says, I can't believe, why did I hit it into the water on number 5? I mean, that is crazy. I thought I had a good shot. I had a 3 hybrid. I thought I hit it good. And it came up short. I said, wow, I didn't play that hole very smart. And you know, I could have played that hole better, but I played this one really good. I'm satisfied. And you're thinking like, okay, what does this mean? You know, what are the lessons I learned? And let me absorb these. They're not paying attention to the news. And when you're on the golf course, you're certainly not paying attention to anything other than, you know, is this putt going to break 3 inches or 2? And I can't really see exactly, is it 3 or 2? And so what should I do? Well, I'll split the difference. And then you miss it and say, doggone it, I should have committed to either the 3 or the 2. At least if I split the difference, I'm going to miss it for sure. But pretty much so. But if I just committed to one or the other, at least I had a 50-50 chance. So it's stupid to try and split the difference there. It's either straight or play for the break, but don't try to do it in between, because then you'll just miss. You'll lip out. Either play for the break or play straight. Don't be stupid. So it helps keep your attention off of the world, is what it does. Off of all this nasty, nasty stuff the ego is getting us ready for the collapse of civilization. Because we're going to the death-free realm, or at least we're going to accept the Holy Spirit's offer to pay us to be safe, pay us to be well, pay us to be, you know, blissful. Pay us to be in a wonderful place, however that works out. So we're not worried about collapse of civilization. We don't need to put attention on that at all. That's not our shtick anymore. That's the excuse making shtick. So we don't need to pay attention. So it's better to pay attention to beauty right now. Do that. Yeah. Well, one way or another, the Holy Spirit will make it happen. I'm not sure how. Without drawing attention to it, you know? Right? I mean, like I say, well, I'm going to cash out, you know, the meager 401k, and everyone say, no, you can't do that because that's crazy. You won't have a cent to retire on. And then to spend all that money and taking vacations right now, I mean, that'd be the smart thing to do. But then people say, you're a lunatic, you're crazy, we won't let that happen. And then they're going to fight it, you know, and say, you've gone insane and all this stuff. So they'll be drawing too much attention to what you know, what you believe in. But truly, I believe that it's important to keep following the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit has an offer. It'll pay us to not be sick. It will pay us to not be in danger. It'll pay us to not be sick. It'll pay us to be perfect, to be happy, to be blissful. this is an offer I'm going to accept. So I have to get ready for this. I have to get ready for it. So the ordinary way of the world doesn't help me at all. That's the ego. That's getting ready for the ego, what the ego has to offer us, which is what? An great excuse. Collapse of civilization. Even a collapse of the ecosystem of this world. That's a really big excuse. Jesus told us the ego is going to make the biggest excuse ever at the end of this cycle. So, and we're at it. And so this, he says, going to be at least apocryphal gospel does say that Jesus said that. Now, whether that was words put in his mouth by the writers or not, there's a question. But still, he said this is going to be the greatest excuse the ego's ever made. Even to the point, maybe in the destruction of this planet in terms of ecosystem-wise. He said if it wasn't cut short, not a single thing, living thing would still survive on this planet. This is what he said. So that's a big excuse that we're egos, the spirit's fashioning for itself. I don't need to have anything to do with that. I really don't need to. I don't need to make excuses anymore. I don't need excuses. I don't need to be part of that. So I need to get prepared for what the Holy Spirit has, whereas those who are into this excuse, they need to keep pulling their attention down and thinking, well, this is what's normal. Yeah, all these attacks and horrible stuff is happening. This is normal. This is normal for me. So, civilization collapse. Oh, yeah, this is normal. This is great. This is where my attention is. What can I do? I'm in prison. What can I do? I got no choice. I don't need that. Don't need that. Don't need that. So somehow I have to keep on trucking. But I don't want to keep doing the blue collar slave trip. This is the thing. So I don't know. It'll take a miracle of the Holy Spirit, but that's what it specializes in. Why do I have all this heavy, heavy stone in my truck? It just came out of nowhere. Really? So, if that can come out of nowhere, the Holy Spirit can cause something else to come out of nowhere. I'm trying to get in good shape. I did order a pair of golf shoes, used. That's nice, poor slave blue-collar person, right? I go into a golf store, look at all these shoes. I can't afford new golf shoes. At the same hand, you go out on a golf course and you've got some shoes that are just falling apart. People will look at you like, whoa, who's this? I mean, most people on the golf course, the number one thing they go for is the new shoes. Because look, I'm wealthy. I got the newest shoes. So there's a huge industry, golf shoes. And they're super expensive now. I mean, good new golf shoes cost you a couple $100. It's like, wow, no, forget it. It is like, I'm not going to look around. They're getting more and more expensive, the haves and the have-nots. Division, right? So, Holy Spirit says, go on to eBay. Really, he told me you need to look on eBay. I said, what do I look for? I don't know what to look for. Look for white golf shoes your size. So I look for white golf shoes my size. And I came across this pair of golf shoes. It wasn't what I was looking for, I thought, but, anyway, make a long story short, I ended up purchasing them. I got them real cheap. Like about a fifth of what I would have paid. And they're supposed to be very, very comfortable athletic golf shoes. And they have super high ratings. I read the reviews on Amazon for these golf shoes. My gosh, it's amazing. Like everybody, 5 stars. They said, these are going to be the best golf shoes that you've ever worn. Because you feel very athletic in them. It could be great support, great traction. They're just superior. But they're not trendy. They're not that trendy. So I said, "Wow, this is great, because I want to be more athletic and go on the golf course. I want to be an athletic event. I want to feel like I'm an athlete out there, and these shoes really will do that." And so I'll probably end up with, you know, the best golf shoes in the world for like a fifth of the cost of what I would have paid. And so that was an improvement. And then we're almost done here. Yeah, it's getting very close. I ordered a shirt online too. I've been looking for the last 12, 13, 14 years for this particular shirt, and I finally found it online. It's a very simple shirt. It's just a white long sleeve button shirt, linen shirt. It's very classy, very high class type of shirt, but it also symbolizes the philosophical class. It's not blue collar, okay? So you're not sweating in this shirt. But it's not just a business shirt either. It's more like a guru shirt type of thing, or it's a philosophical class shirt. Just white, just pure white, just simple styling. Everything simple but high quality. Finally found it, and I purchased it. It was a tough one because it was somewhat expensive. So it really hurt. But it was used, of course. Philosophers can't be proud in that way. I won't get anything unless it's new. That was used. But I've been looking for this shirt over and over, and finally there it was. But I said, oh boy, I got to pull the trigger on this one, and I did. So that's coming too. That is coming too. And white is a good look. White's the new look. This is for the philosophical class. White is the new look. No pattern. No patterns, no color, no patterns, just pure white. Purity, true purity, Holy Spirit purity. Not the good woman purity, but Holy Spirit purity. Same reason I got this jacket. It has the red as an accent, which means pragmatically, we're still believing in form. Pragmatically, flesh, just a tiny little trace of it, so to speak, but the rest of it is just this beautiful, pure white. So, white is the new, it is, you know, it's the new thing, philosophical class. I wore white shoes to the Christmas Eve Mass, white shoes, stunning white shoes. Priests wore white too. White is a symbol of purity and hope and true life. So, this stuff's coming. It's in the pipeline. And getting ready for something here. Stay in good shape. Best you can. Don't give up. It's all appearance here. It's all excuse making. If we drop, say, I don't need to make this excuse, we can recover from anything. You can even rise from the dead, from the grave. Jesus told Lazarus, arise. Your faith made you whole. Say Lazarus' faith that made him whole. The spirit of Lazarus said, I don't want to use this, my death, as an excuse. Okay, but I need a little help, boost from Jesus and my encouragement. Jesus says, okay, Lazarus, stand, rise from the grave, stand up and walk. And he did. He did. I believe Jesus raised people from the dead. Absolutely. Absolutely, I believe that. It's completely in line with reason and truth. It was their own faith, their own willingness that really caused them to rise from the grave. Jesus would say that. It's your own faith that made you whole. Really. I'm just a helpful catalyst here, reminding you can do this. Getting a nice run here, aren't I?
That's great.
And of course, Jesus raised himself from the grave too, saying, look, what I can do, you can do as well. Because I don't need to use it as an excuse. I don't need death as an excuse. I don't need a body as an excuse. Certainly don't need a dead body as an excuse at all. Just all excuse making to displace futility of trying to do the impossible. We don't need to do the impossible. We don't need to try to do the impossible. There's no necessity to this whatsoever. God didn't give us the necessity to try to do the impossible. Okay, I hope it ends soon because I am freezing. 2:30. We hit the big 2:30. That means full blast, full power. We got full power here. And certainly, we've put full power into this video. Great way to start out the new year, right? That means we've shifted gears into high gear right now. Absolutely, our attention is shifting onto better and better clarity. Very, very important to see what we've seen in this video. Key dynamic. We've gone over some extraordinarily root key dynamics here. And this is probably pretty much it now. It's still going though. But it is going likely to click off any moment. So, all right. Have a .. new year. Have a shift of attention new year. Have a Holy Spirit new year, actually. Have a Holy Spirit shifting your attention new year. Have a my attention is on the Holy Spirit new year. Have a great new year in that regard, in that context. And maybe we'll have a short year, right? Which would be fine, right? Short year. I mean, who wants another full year of this nonsense in the world? My gosh, it's getting really bare knuckle time here in the world, to say the least. All right. Very great. It's probably going to be it here. If it went to 4 gigabytes. And that's usually when it says, that's all.